All right. We're going to move on to the next topic now.
All right.
And we're going to be exploring... we're going to be exploring the idea of subgenres and classification in hip-hop and whether or not they're still necessary. Because right now, in the modern age of hip-hop, so many different styles and sounds are being meshed into a... I don't even know what you want to call it, like a pot, like a melting pot of sounds, so that maybe subgenres aren't as...
Juxtaposition, if you will.
Juxtaposed, yes. 100%. Thank you for the assist. To the point where... You know, a lot of modern hip-hop and rap on both sides of the pond, I'd probably argue, of very much don't need certain labels upon them. So we're just going to explore that that whole idea and whether, you know, subgenres and classification in hip-hop still matter. How do we feel, boys?
Who wants to hit it first?
Ray J.
I think I kind of see that both sides of the argument. That was mad.
That's very good.
I think I see both sides of the argument, and I can see how like restrictive having like subgenres can be and being placed in the box, because you might not want that, and eventually you might want to break out of that. But at the same time, I think it's quite useful for like, I guess, telling people about, if you're describing an artist, you're describing what they do, then like, I guess, describing the type of music that they make as far as a subgenre might be useful and helpful, innit? So I can see kind of how it works on both sides, but I think I lean more towards not being pigeonholed in it and the use for it. Do we really need it? Because it's all rap music, innit? It's all hip-hop music, so do we really need it?
Yeah, I mean, I guess the actual like differences, if we're talking about sounds like trap and drill that are wholly different to maybe like boom, bap and all that stuff, which even in itself is a classification, there is a room and there is a space for that, because again, like you say, it's a differentiator for certain artists. Like Lil Uzi Vert makes all kinds of music. Migos made trap music, but they also made hip hop sort of thing. But you know, if you really break it down, it's trap music sort of thing. Pop Smoke made drill music, so you know, there is space for it. But yeah, I mean, in that sense, yeah, that's fine. But generally, I'm with you. It's like, you don't want to necessarily... The connotations of classifying is the pigeonholing, which a lot of artists don't necessarily agree with, because they're bigger than that and they're worth... And they're better than that sort of thing. Not better, but they're bigger than that. And they want to show that. So, yeah, I guess it's a thing where it is very useful as a guide, especially if you're like you're not a hip-hop fan and you want to know what my man is making and you can tell them. But at the same time, it's a bit like... It's not necessarily a stick that you want to be beaten with all the time.
Where did subgenres come from? Was it the like record labels?
I think they come from the streets, right?
I was going to say the people.
They come from the people.
Really? Because like, if I say to you, Joe Black, you might say road rapper. If I say you did Migos,
no, trap. But I'm talking about the very like origin of like subgenres. When did like it really become a thing? Because I guess at the beginning it was all just rap music, innit?
I don't know. I guess people made derivations of certain genres. And then, you know, just put a title on it. And then I guess people made that link. This is a subgenre of, this came from. So I think subgenre is probably just byproducts of just like language. And then the streets did the rest with the genres. And there you go. Look, I personally think that subgenres are useful. I don't necessarily agree that they... you know, will have any sort of negative impacts on the artists for too long. I think it's the artist's responsibility, for example, to break that.
To break
that
up?
Yeah. To prove to people that that's not the only thing you can define them by. That's on the artist, right? Journalists and what have you, for the most part, will be lazy. They want to just put quick labels on things. But like, if you think about rock music, if you think about like other styles of music, right? Having subgenres is actually quite useful, because you might have people who don't like hip hop but do like trap. Because when you think about trap, it's a different BPM. It's a different, it's different content. It's like there's all different things that go into a subgenre. Some people might not like garage but might like grime, or vice versa. We often had it the other way around, right? They'd like garage but not like grime, etc., etc. But it's good to have those subcategories, because when you're searching for music, some people just search based on a genre, right?
So you're looking at it from a logistical standpoint.
I think labels are important.
What about for the artist, though?
I mean, I don't know how it really impacts the artist as such. For me, like, if the subgenre gets very, very hot then the artist, it all submerges anyway, right? You know, it's you know, it's not lost on me that like Asake, for example, and Burna Boy Sumba, the remix, is basically an amapiano beat. Do you know what I mean? Like, if you really, really peel it back, it's like everything ends up like submerging. So I don't know if it hurts the artist, because the artists, they jump between genres anyway because they know that it's beneficial for their pocket and for their fan base. So but, I don't know if it hurts them too much.
But because of that, they might feel a way about being termed as something else because they're genre hopping. So if I'm like a trap artist and I'm still, and I'm doing Jersey Club along with drill and a little bit of that, and I'm still being known as a trap artist, then like you say, journalists and just the general conversation around them is lazy, but that will be annoying for certain artists as well, especially if they're carving out a niche for themselves as being a little bit more original than that.
Because you'll still be pigeonholed. You'll still be looked at a certain way. No matter if you peel out.
If you put out a song for Universal Records and it goes on Spotify and it goes on Apple Music or whatever, like, the labels are ultimately giving you that genre. They've genred your music. And you've had something to do with that. It's not like you've come out as a pop artist and then the journalists have called you a rapper. You've come out with either a bunch of trap songs, which have made people think you're a trap artist, or the songs that you've put out have had that genre attached to it. So it's not really anybody else's fault, but the people who put out the shit.
But there also have been situations where rappers have made certain type of rap music and then they've been placed in that box, and when they've tried to break out of it, it hasn't been good for them. Like someone like a Rock Marciano can't make trap music. It just won't run. And it's because he's kind of stuck in that, I wouldn't even call it boom bap, but more like lo-fi? Call it lo-fi?
Dust.
Yeah, like dusty, like East Coast, like soul sample-y type of groove in it. So he can't break out of that. So I think there are disadvantages to the subgenre thing.
Why can't he break out of it?
I think he'll get backlash, and I don't think he'll be as successful.
But I think the backlash is the result of doing it. But why can't he actually do it?
I mean, nothing's stopping him physically doing it.
He can do it. It's just the more of the feedback that he will get. Because once you've been doing your sound for so long.
Little Yachty did the same. Tyler the Creator said the same, right? Like, these people don't want to be, artists don't want to be put into boxes for the most part. But it is their responsibility when they make the music to make it clear to everybody who is covering them and to people who are listening to them that this is where they are right now. It's, people are going to be lazy. Like, people are going to, you know, Tyler the Creator is always going to be a rapper to people because the majority of his career has been rap in a certain kind of music. So it's not really the audience's fault. It's nobody's fault. Like, if you want to change perceptions, you as an artist need to do the work yourself. You can't just wake up one day and be like, I'm a singer.
But when Tyler the Creator wins Best Rap Album for Ego, which isn't a rap album, is that his fault?
No. But that was the Grammys, and the Grammys are a fucking awful institution, right? Like, I think that's the only institution that did that. I think everybody knew that that was a pop album. I knew I wasn't listening to a rap album, but there's a lot of rap on Ego.
Is there?
Yeah.
I'd have to listen again.
Like songs like New Magic Wand, that's rap. You know what I mean? It's just a slightly different form of rap, but it is what it is. The biggest song was Earthquake, and that's not a rap song, but it's kind of rappy. Like,
but nowhere near, I suppose.
Yeah. So I don't know, man. Like, it's a tricky one, because if there are artists that kind of are multi-genre, then they're the ones who probably suffer the most, because in their mind, they want to be something that nobody else has really cottoned on to. Like, nobody's going to be as creative or as good at the labeling of an artist as an artist is going
to
be.
Why can't it just be rap music? Why does it have to
be? Well, then he wouldn't be happy though with that. Because he's just like, you're boxing me in. That's what Lil Yachty said.
Yeah, I mean,
he come up with an album that sounds like something like Tame Impala would do. And he's like, don't call me a rapper. And by the way, I hate that, by the way. When rappers are like, don't call me a rapper. I'm not, as if to say, like, being a rapper is this subgenre in itself. Like,
I think, yeah, Post
Malone. Nah, I know what you mean.
I hate that shit. Don't diminish rap. I hate that. But, you know. I mean, for you, because you to come out and be like, don't just call me a rapper means, like, what? That being a rapper is, like, the lowest form of artistry.
I don't take it as that. I think it's more so, well, at least from my understanding of it, obviously Lil Yachty is known as being a rapper, but he wants people to show that he's just an artist. Maybe he went about saying that clumsily, but I think it's more so like, I'm more than just a rapper, rather than don't call me a rapper. You know what I mean?
All of your career up until this one album has been rap.
Yeah, for sure.
And you've been all right being called a rapper.
cool, but yeah. he's in a different stage right now.
Cool, so he's prove it. Prove it, because by the way, he made that one album and then the next thing he did was release Holster. So that's straight it. Back to what he was doing before. Mm. Don't call me a rapper though.
I guess at that time he wanted to be known as something else. Mm.
Yeah,
and
crazy.
That I think that's okay. Like even if all he did was rap up until that point, if he then reaches a point where he wants to do a little bit more, and I mean that album that he dropped is very like, well, for at least anyway for me, it was very artistic in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
And if he kind of wants to, for lack of a better term, distance himself from the rapper title, for the sake of you know, finding artistic, you know, I suppose clarity with himself, then I'm not too mad at it.
I think artists get precious. Like for example, I will always call Andre 3000 a rapper. We literally just spoke about it, right?
Mm.
But this guy plays piano, guitar, a broken flute in New York in a park surrounded by pigeons.
Mm.
I'd still call him a rapper.
Mm. Mm.
He made The Love Below and I'd still call him a rapper. Mm. And I don't think he'd be pissed off about that.
Mm.
Right? I just think artists get precious. So I don't think subgenres really, really hurt. Imagine if we called Andre 3000 a jazz artist. Would that be correct?
Mm.
Yes.
Yeah, no.
Not really.
Did you say yes?
I'm joking.
No. But yeah, okay. But like, it wouldn't be. It wouldn't
imagine,
be right.
Imagine a world without subgenres. Like, what does that look like without it?
What do you mean?
What does it look like
without subgenres?
Yeah. Would we still
lazy? It looks a bit more lazy.
And what everyone's making
without subgenres?
What continue making the same music because people go to rap. The label of it?
Yeah, it's just all rap.
Yeah. We'll be rap.
But would that be a problem?
Yeah.
Why?
Because there are strands of...
If you're singing, then cool. That's a different conversation. But if you're making like a type of rap music that might be a bit more advanced than what's been made already...
Think about it as rock.
Right.
Rock.
R&B.
Blues rock. Blues.
Let's use R&B.
Blues, folk, country, grunge, punk. Like, these are very different forms of rock.
Yeah.
So subgenres allow you to hone in. Huh?
Folk, is that rock?
Folk is a version. Yeah. It's a form of rock, for sure. Like, it's... Okay. Like, you want the subgenres because it allows you to drill in. Like, if you only like drill, for example, a lot of people don't like fuck with, like, hip-hop, but, like, just like drill. They love that skip. They love it. Give me a subgenre so I can go into SoundCloud or I can go into whatever type and drill and I get what I like.
But with R&B and soul music, there aren't no subgenres in that. You've got neo-soul, but...
Alternative R&B?
Yeah, alternative R&B.
What the fuck is that?
I consider what Lucky Day and Miguel do as very, very different to, like, I don't know... Yeah, like your boy, Chris Brown and Usher. Like, it's very different.
That's what R&B, man.
Nah, it's different.
No, there's different.
Okay, I can differentiate between R&B and soul music. Those two are different. But under the umbrella of R&B, it's all R&B.
I look at Miguel as the same.
Under the umbrella of soul music, you might have neo soul, but it's just soul.
I look at Miguel as R&B. No matter what it's called, but I look at him as, maybe it's not traditional R&B, but Miguel's always an R&B artist to me.
Yeah, he's R&B.
When I listen to Kaleidoscope Dreams, I was thinking it's R&B album.
Yeah, if I'm telling you about an R&B artist to go check out, I'm not going to start dissecting the type of R&B. I'm just going to be like, yo, bruv, there's this dope R&B artist. Go.
Yeah, but you,
but they do
someone
exist,
like
though.
Me.
But the different strands do exist, though.
You know me, like, I'm very, very particular about
that. I don't know. I don't relate to that, though.
Yeah, I can't be having like just any guy whispering sweet nothings into my ear over like melodic music, right? So I'm very, very picky about my R&B. So like, if you're talking about like guitar-driven R&B, the kind that Miguel makes, if you're thinking about stuff that's slightly more upbeat and a little bit more playful and a little bit more alternative, like a Lucky Day, for example, I kind of want to know that, you know? Like, I like Van Hunt is for me, like, one of the greatest R&B acts. But even him, like, he can switch to something that sounds like it's like a Lenny Kravitz song.
Absolutely.
To sound like it sounds like something that, you know, one of the aforementioned would make. So for me, it's actually quite important to have that classification because I don't want to press play and then, like, it be, I don't know, as yet.
Mm.
I mean, that was a classic. That was.
I don't need that personally, man. I don't need subgenres, man. If it's a new rapper that's come out, you man, just tell me that, like, yo, man, there's this dope rapper.
I'll figure out what he is.
No, this is cap.
What you
because
mean?
Because this guy doesn't like trap. So imagine if we just sent him amazing albums. We were like, this is a dope hip hop album, and then he came back to us and was like, nah, it's that trap shit.
Yeah, and he don't like drill.
That would happen.
So yeah.
So you need it. You know you need it. You don't like trap.
I think you know what you don't like, but I think he don't care about the umbrella.
Yeah, I don't need the title.
How would you feel
it?
If everything was titled as hip hop and then I sent you something and then it was trap or it was drill in your case?
Yeah, I see what you're saying.
You feel me?
I see what you're saying.
Subgenres are good.
I see what you're saying.
It can be useful.
I think so.
Yeah, because then you can deduce whether you actually want to listen or not.
But it can hinder artists though. If an artist comes out making one sort of like subgenre rap, then yeah, it might be a bit tricky when they want to break out of that.
Yeah.
And I've got a list on my phone of like as many subgenres as I can find. I've got
I had some as well.
I've got G-Funk, West Coast rap, I've got East Coast, boom bap, dusty rap, street rap, jazz rap, alternative rap, trap rap, southern rap, conscious rap.
You forgot one.
Lo-fi rap, mumble rap.
You forgot one.
Crunk rap. Ringtone rap, horrorcore rap.
You said ringtone rap.
Is it gonna come? I wonder if it's gonna come.
That's all I got.
I had crunk, I had drill, grime.
Drill, yeah.
I got trap and I got light skinned females.
What's your problem?
That's a genre. Okay, I hear you now.
What's your problem?
I mean, to be fair,
that's probably because they all do.
That's probably the most
same,
popping genre right now. To be fair,
it's a new subgenre. It's a new subgenre.
But yeah, I don't know, man. I don't really.
That was a great list of subgenres.
Yeah, man. I don't know. I don't really. I understand like it why it might be useful, but I don't necessarily need.
There's also a list of subgenres where there's a group of people that don't like they shower, and that's like a subgenre. There's a collective unit. Like Childish Gambino don't like he showers, and there's a selective
Aesop Rock.
Yeah, like there's a selective group of. I don't care what you lot can put them in any genre you want.
Yellow,
I put them in
yellow will stop showering
like a daily snack. They are in a collective unit of they don't shower. They don't do their daily showers. They stink.
Donald Glover actually like legit wasn't showering.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. Like,
I think he showed up to Breakfast Club and Charlamagne was like, you're pungent.
You see, Carla, that's, yeah, add him to the list.
Yeah, that's wild.
The don't shower subgenre.
Yeah, it's crazy.
Do you want to add any more while we're here?
What was the Laffy Taffy? What was that? Is that clip?
The Laffy
Taffy. Clip music. What was the Laffy Taffy? What was that subgenre called?
What do you call that, man?
That was kind of recorded ringtone rap, no?
No, but that was bad though. Stomp It Down. There was a few of them songs that was all coming out at the same time.
Wasn't that also called Trap before Trap became Trap? Or was it Snap?
The trap that we know today wasn't the trap.
That's why I'm hot. Miami bass as well, chopped and screwed.
What does that come out? This is why I'm hot.
Yeah,
what does that come out?
That's actually similar era to
like ringtone rap. I think that's like the ringtone rap. Ringtone rap. Because to me, trap was the TIs, the Jeezy's.
Yeah.
To me, that's when it really, really came.
Yeah.
But yeah, I guess ringtone rap. I think that was all ringtone rap. You're right. Because that was all cranked out.
Yeah. So I guess it doesn't matter.
They matter in all genres. So why wouldn't it matter in rap? I guess, in a sense. I suppose the only thing for me was, from the artistic standpoint, not being pigeonholed. But again, Denise's point, it's up to them to define what they are effectively for them to be considered what they want to be considered as.
Rob Marciano has never described his sound as like lo-fi, drumless, like hip-hop. He's never done that. He's just like, yo, I just make music, innit? Do you know what I mean?
But he knows what he makes, though.
Yeah, cool, but he doesn't describe it the way other people describe it. So I don't think I think because of that, he doesn't really allow himself to be pigeonholed, even though he is known for making this style of rap.
But in a weird way, he's kind of pigeonholing himself by making the same... I mean, I can't talk as much about
that's
it.
That's what I'm saying. It's on the artists.
But if he keeps making the same type of music, then he's effectively
you're in a rabbit hole.
I disagree with that.
You're in a rabbit hole.
I think if he's like naming it, then cool. That's him pigeonholing himself. But if he's just making what he wants to make... I get what you're saying. I don't think that's him pigeonholing.
If he hasn't
himself.
Put a label on it, then he's technically, in his mind, not making the same music over and over again.
Because you actually don't know what he's going to do on his next album.
That's not a bad point.
You just assume because of what he's done before, but that's your business. That's
if you put a label on it, then you're ultimately putting him in that rabbit
Absolutely.
Hole. I get that. That's not a bad point, to be fair. I still think that we have discernment as fans, though, right? So we understand genres, we understand language, we understand patterns, conventions, tempos, all of that. So we are going to label people. Like, humans are only comfortable if they're able to like classify a stereotype label
in it. People in boxes.
So yeah, if you stick to a convention, then people will label that convention. Even if you're the only person making that type of music, people will call it that. So again, circling back, it is important for artists to not sonically stay in the same path too long if they do not want to be stamped.
Fair dues.
I blame the corporations, man. It's them.
Institutions.
The white man. Yes, absolutely them, bro. I think they started the whole subgenre thing, man. And journalists. I blame them too. They weren't these artists.
I'm not joining this.
The white man created absolutely. The subgenre.
No, I mean,
so it wasn't. It wasn't the brother man. It was the
other man. Absolutely. I don't know a rapper in like the early like 80s or 90s. I was like, yo, man, I made gangster rapper, I made this or I made that. I don't know that, man. That came from these labels and the white
man. Man.
So what do you say to grime artists or grime rappers who weren't calling it grime back then, but they were calling it, what were they calling it? They're calling it like dark garage or like... Grimy Garage.
I didn't know that. That's what they were calling. I don't know, man. I don't know what I'd say to them.
When Dre and them man were making G-Funk, they were calling that shit G-Funk, yeah.
Yeah.
But maybe you find out
it's
later.
It's a mixture, they were. I'd say.
Maybe you find out later on as
it's
well.
It's like you said earlier, like, a lot of it comes from the streets and what the actual artists themselves are calling. Like,
they often coin it themselves.
It definitely comes from the streets, definitely.
You know?
All right, fine, then I'll give you that. And that's one instance.
Peter so it was the brother man.
Peter just wanted to blame the corporation for something.
No, Peter wanted to blame.
Peter just wanted to blame the corporation for something.
Peter wanted to blame the other man.
I feel like the white man did it first. I feel like they wrote about it first, and then these man likes the sound. It was like, yeah, man, I made G-Funk.
You know what they say,
hip-hop
right?
Definitely came from us.
Yeah, for sure. It's ours. It's been ours.
I mean, it came from us, but it's very much not ours anymore.
Yeah. I mean, shout out to
Lucian Grange.
Shout out to Jack Harlow.
I mean, shout out to Lucian Grange.
I shout out Jack Harlow as soon as you said that. I don't know why.
Are you watching White Men Can't Jump?
No.
Who needed that? I'm annoyed. Yo, anyway.
I don't think I've ever seen that.
What?
White Man Can't Jump. I've never seen it.
The original?
You've never watched
it? Fam. You ain't seen Rosie Perez in that?
Never seen the original? You've never seen it?
Never seen
it. When man went to go get his gun?
I saw her and Do the Right Thing.
Bruh, you need to see her in White Man Can't Jump.
Yeah. But anyway.
Okay.
So Yemi, what's the conclusion of this?
I guess we still need subgenres, right?
I'm gonna push back on that. I don't know if we did like coin these terms ourselves. I need to do some research.
We definitely coined hip hop. We definitely coined hip hop.
Bro, no, I'm not talking about hip hop, I'm talking about subgenres.
The white man in his suit wasn't around when the music was being made. The white man in the suit came when the music was made and they wanted to pillage, rape, steal, kill.
The white man did not call crunk crunk.
Yeah. There saying we're gonna call
no,
this.
No, I'm talking
one
about yeah, but I'm talking about like the early stuff. I'm talking about the early stuff.
No, everything was us, man. Everything.
You don't think so?
Drill was us.
You think that was Derek next to Marley Marl saying this is hippity hop dog.
They hit.
No, but I feel like these labels needed to like
once they needed to put it in,
so that they knew how to market.
What the labels done is once it became a thing, they latched onto it. Once drill became a thing, they latched onto the back of
the label. The label sell the finished product.
Drill was already drilled by the time the labels found out. When Pop Smoke came out, drill was already drilled by then.
100%.
But they just got into the back of that and fired the cannon.
I don't know about
but what anyway, conclusion is we need them. But
we'll present facts to him and he'll just be like,
I mean, it makes sense that
when the white man's involved, he does not want to
make sense. It makes sense that the white man was trying to put us in boxes.
You know what?
Why am I going to do my research?
You know what I realized?
I'll do my research. I'll come back, and if I'm wrong, I'm wrong. No. I don't know though.
Why am I debating?
Will you apologize to the white man after that?
No, I'm not doing that.
No.
I apologize to my people when they. Nah,
I receive my thought process. I'm with him until they apologize to. You know what, there, man. Yemi, summarize it.
600 years old.
600 years of goddamn perpetuity.
All right. We're gonna wrap up now with the fun topic because this is gonna go somewhere we don't need it to go.
So peace to the gods of the earth, man.
What we're gonna
that's
do
how they
is
get you. They talk about something serious and they cover the fun topic after.
That's how they distract you, fam. Cause ain't it evil to live back?
Yeah, Mr. the white man. That's sick. Man, they're putting you in with them, man. They're putting you in with the other man, bro. I don't know how I feel about that.
What's a fun topic?
Bro, man. I don't know. I like that.
The maddest thing about that is that we collaboratively came up with a fun topic.
Shit.
No, you're running. What's the fun topic?
Distraction tactics. Hold on.
My guy. Yeah, what's the fun topic? Yeah, you men are sickos, by the way.
Shit.
This guy, you call me COINTELPRO. That's mad.
Who called you COINTELPRO?
That is wild. That is wild.
Never.
Anyway, sorry, Yemi, what's the fun topic?
Shout out Fred Hampton.